Welcome to e-lecture series for BTech 6M, subject Artificial Intelligence. Myself Prakash Meena, Assistant Professor, Computer Science and Engineering, Engineering College Ajmer. So today's topic is the theory of learning. So let's start with our topic. Okay. So the main unanswered question in learning is how can we be sure that our learning algorithm has produced a hypothesis that will predict the correct value for previously unseen inputs. And informal way, how do we know that the hypothesis H is close to the target function F if we don't know what F is? And this type of question have been pondered for several years. So in recent years, other questions have also emerged. How many examples do we need to get a good edge, and what hypothesis space should we use? If the hypothesis space is very complex, can we ever find the best edge, or do we have to settle for a local maximum in the space of hypothesis? And how complex should edge be, and how do we avoid overfitting? So we will start with the questions of how many examples are needed for learning. So we already see from the learning curve for decision tree learning on the restaurant problem. So here is the curve problem. So this is our problem, restaurant problem related learning curve, and that improves with more training data. Learning curves are useful, but they are specific to a particular learning algorithm on a particular problem. So again, are there some more general principle governing the number of examples needed in general? So question like this are addressed by computational learning theory. Computational learning theory. So this type of questions are included or addressed by computational learning theory, which lies at the intersection of AI, statistics and theoretical computer science. So underlying principle is that one hypothesis that is seriously wrong will almost certainly be found out with high probability after a small number of examples, because it will make an incorrect prediction, and thus any hypothesis that is consistent with a sufficiently large set of training examples is unlikely to be seriously wrong, and that is it must be probably approximately correct. So that is our PAC. And any learning algorithm that returns hypotheses that are probably approximately correct is called a PAC learning algorithm. So we can use this approach to provide bounds on the performance of various learning algorithms. Then PAC learning theorems, like all theorems, are logical consequences of axioms. When a theorem states something about the future based on the past, the axioms have to provide the all details to make that connection. And for PAC learning, the all details provided by the stationary assumptions which says that the future examples are going to be drawn from the same fixed distribution. Probability E is equal to probability of P X Y as past example. So in addition, to keep things simple, we will assume that the true function F is deterministic and is a member of the hypothesis class H. So that is being considered. So here H bad, you see. Then the simplest PAC theorem deal with Boolean functions for which the 0 by 1 loss is appropriate, and the error rate of a hypothesis H defined informally earlier is defined formally here as the expected generalization error for examples drawn from the stationary author distributions. So here error H is equal to जनरल लॉस, जनरलाइजेशन लॉस एल जीरो बाय वन एच इज इक्वल टू समेशन ऑफ एल जीरो बाय वन वाई कॉमा एच एक्स इंटू प्रोबेबिलिटी एक्स कॉमा वाई. सो हियर यू कैन सी द इक्वेशन. एंड इन अदर वर्ड्स एरर एच इज द प्रोबेबिलिटी दैट एच मिस क्लासिफाइज ए न्यू एग्जाम्पल एंड दिस इज द सेम क्वान्टिटी बींग मेजर्ड एक्सपोनेंशली बाय द लर्निंग कर्व शोन अर्लियर. So hypothesis H is called approximately correct if error H is less than equal to E, where E is a small constant. So here we are missing here something. Okay, we will correct it. We will write here a small. Okay, 1 minute. And write here about E, and then we can write. Actually, its E is different in reference book, so you can see about this. Okay, we have corrected it here. Okay, now so error H is less than equal to E, where E is a small constant, and we will so that we can found an n such that after seeing n examples with high probability, all consistent hypotheses will be approximately correct. And one can think of an approximately correct hypothesis as being close to the true function in hypothesis space, and it lies inside with what is called the E ball. Here you can see E ball actual. So we have written as a E ball around the true function f, and the hypothesis space outside this ball is called H bad. So here you can see H bad. We have also shown original H bad here. So next we can calculate the probability that a seriously wrong hypothesis H B belongs to H bad is consistent with the first n examples as follows. So we know that error H B greater than E, thus the probability that it agree with a given example is at most 1 minus E. Okay, so since the examples are independent, the bound for n example is here probability H B agrees with n example, this is less than equal to 1 minus E the power n. So the probability that H bad contains at least one consistent hypothesis is bounded by the sum of the individual probabilities. So here again probability H bad contains a consistent hypothesis less than equal to mod of H bad 1 minus E to power n less than equal to mod H 1 minus E power n. So here where we have used the fact that H mod H bad is less than equal to mod H, and we would like to reduce the probability this event below some small number delta. So here H mod H 1 minus E to the power n less than equal to delta, and given that 1 minus E less than equal to E minus minus E small, so we can achieve this if we allow the algorithm to see. So here is the equation 1, n is greater than equal to 1 by E in integration 1 my 1 by delta plus integration mod H. So example, thus if a learning algorithm returns a hypothesis that a consistent with this main many examples, then with the probability at least 1 minus delta it has error at most E, and in other words it is probably approximately correct, and the number of required examples as a function of E and delta is called the sample complexity of the hypothesis space. So earlier we saw that if h is the set of all boolean function on a n attributes, then mod h is equal to 2 to the power n. Thus the sample complexity of the space grows as 2 to the power n, because the number of possible examples is also 2 to the power n. And this suggests that PAC learning in the class of all boolean functions requires seeing all or nearly all the possible examples, and a moment's thoughts reveals the reason for this. H contains enough hypotheses to classify any given set of examples in all possible ways, and in particular for any set of n examples, the set of hypotheses consistent with those examples contains equal number of hypotheses that predict x n plus 1 to be the positive and hypotheses that predict x n plus 1 to be negative. So to obtain real generalization to unseen examples, then it seems we need to restrict the hypothesis space H in some way. And but of course if we do restrict the space, we might eliminate the true function altogether, and there are three ways to escape this dilemma. So first is bring prior knowledge to bear on the problem, and the second is to insist that the algorithm returns not just any consistent hypothesis but preferably a simple one, and in cases where finding simple consistent hypothesis is tractable and the simple complexity results are generally better than the analysis based only on consistency. And the third escape is to focus on learnable subsets of entire hypothesis space of Boolean function. This approach relies on the assumptions that the restricted language contains a hypothesis as that is close enough to the true function f, and the benefits are that the restricted hypothesis space allows for effective generalization and is typically easier to search. So that's all about PAC and PAC learning algorithm and computational learning theory. So session ends here. Thank you.